Hello, everybody. Welcome to the next talk. Here is Sebastian Graf. He is Head of Solution Architecture at Xantaro in Frankfurt, and he will present you about building a transparent layer 1 switch using P4.
Thanks, Nicola. So, my name is Sebastian, and I'm going to give you some insights about a small internal research project where we actually tried to build a transparent layer 1 switch using P4. So let's start with some disclaimers first. So although this presentation has P4 in the title, I'm actually not going to show you any P4 code. I'm also not going to give you a deep dive introduction into the P4 language, mainly because this is just a lightning talk, so we are a bit limited in time. And also there has already been a very good introduction into this topic by Aaron A. Glenn on DNOC 10. So I encourage you to have a look at the recording and also to his slide deck, which is available on the links in here. So let's start a bit with the problem statement or why we actually went down this path. So the frequent DNOC attendees may remember that Xantaro is operating a multi-vendor lab network in Frankfurt. My colleague Tobias gave an introduction to this, how we used automation tools for the infrastructure at DNOC 9. So also here, have a look at his slide deck if you're interested in it. And we frequently have challenges that the pre-cabled standard topologies are not enough for our colleagues during their tests. So they come up with additional cabling requests, and then we frequently run into different side of problems, like we run out of ports, we run out of transceivers that we could plug in into ports, we run out of budget in order to buy new transceivers that we could plug into the ports, or we simply run out of time, because especially in these times, it could be a bit challenging because every cable you have to patch means that somebody needs to go to the office. And as probably many other companies, also Xantaro has currently a work from home policy as far as it works. So yeah, quite some challenges. And our first problem or solution to this problem was also mentioned out by Tobias in this mentioned talk. So obviously the solution, if you don't have enough ports in your devices, you just put a switch in between. This is what we did. We had some QFX switches from Juniper in our lab that originally were purchased for a QFabric deployment that we no longer require for various reasons. We basically made a virtual chassis out of them, later on plugged in some additional switches into them. We also had one time where we had a virtual chassis that we like to call Frankenfabrik, because it was composed out of 6 different models of 4 different EX and QFX series. But they worked quite well. We even, for fun, did some ISS use during the lifetime of this, and they just worked out, which is, we were quite happy about this. Not that I'm a big fan of ISSU for different vendors, regardless of vendors, but well, it's lab networks, so we just tried it out. Basically, we were quite happy with the solutions because it allows our lab users to just interconnect their devices by providing a standard layer 2 VLAN, hook the two ports of the respective devices in it, and they are connected. So that works quite okay for layer 3 and above, but there are some challenges as soon as you come to layer 2, where you always find some kind of ugly protocols that are not being transmitted by the switch, but they're actually eaten by the switch, because the switch considers these frames very interesting, so it intercepts them and sends them to the control plane. And the other problem is that it is a switch, so it behaves like one, so it's not really transparent. Even though you have some kind of tunneling possibilities for different protocols, but you always find one where it either doesn't work or it's just not implemented. So therefore, we had a look about alternative solutions, what we could actually do. And actually on the market, they are ready to use layer 1 switching solutions, which usually are either patch robots or work after the optical, electrical, optical principle. So the patch robots are quite nice. It's basically a robot with a lot of fiber optic connections. You connect two ports to it, and then you can tell it that it should actually interconnect these two ports, and then these two ports will actually be linked together. So that is quite nice. However, the problem is it takes quite some rack space. You have to decide whether you want to go for single mode or multi-mode. Also the connectors you have to decide that you will want to use. Alternative is the optical, electrical, optical principle, which more or less looks like a standard switch with SFP or QCP28 cages, depending on the speed that you buy this for. This is quite nice because it's really transparent, because it actually gets the data that is being received by the optic that you plug into one of the ports, And then it just sends this data as they are being received, simplified speaking, just to the outgoing optic. And so this is also a quite transparent solution. So we found, hey, this is quite interesting. So let's get some quotes for them for an interconnect matrix in order to interconnect some 100G ports. And as soon as we got the offer, we were hitting the out of budget error again. So we thought, well, let's look at something else. And we still had from some white box switch evaluations to wedge 100BF 32X switches in our lab. And these switches actually are a bit different from what you usually have in these kind of devices, because they have a barefoot Tofino ASIC in them. And you actually, as the user, have the possibility to program these devices and tell them what they should actually do. This is the only thing where I'm going to be a bit of a insight into the P4. So if you compare this P4 approach to a classical approach, where you have a chipset vendor like Broadcom, for example, who develops the chipsets and defines how the tables should look like in here. It provides an SDK to your device vendor, which may be Juniper, Arista, Cisco, or whoever. And this device vendor then is responsible for building the network operating system, for defining the CLI and API. And you as the operator are then told how to use this thing. Now with P4, this looks a bit different. You still have a device vendor who brings down all the physical components and sells you a switch. However, you are absolutely free to what you do with the network operating system. You could define your own CLI and API for it. You could define your own tables. Obviously, you're still somehow limited to what the SDK offers, but in case of P4, you really can tell the chipset what it should actually do. And this was the point where we thought, okay, if we need to tell it what we should do, then it's probably very easy to tell it not to do anything with ugly protocols. So here are the high-level steps, what you actually need to do in order to get a P4 program running on the wedge switch. Because basically, if you power it up, it's just a doorstopper with 32 or 100 gig ports, but you can actually then program it with P4. And turns out the P4 program itself is quite simple, because in our case, it's just a program that inspects the incoming interface, looks up in a table where it should egress this frame, and then just forwards this frame out of the responsive port. However, there's some steps you need to do in order to get to this point. So the switch boots into open network install environment or ONI. So you need to load an open a NOS to it, a network operating system. We decided to go for open network Linux. So we had to clone the repo, apply the patch from the chipset vendor. We had to build the image, upload the image, copy hardware specific packages to ONL afterwards, compile the SDK of the vendor, install it, and then actually write a P4 program, change the interface bits as we required them. And then finally, we were able to put up some stuff into the forwarding lookup tables. And we were actually getting some frames sent over it. So the cool thing is, once a packet reaches the Tofino chipsets, it is just there as a sequence of zero and ones. And you have to give some value to it or tell it what it actually do. So as we didn't tell anything about the packet, how it should look like, the frames were just sent out and will just receive on the other end. So we tested LACP and other ugly stuff. We also tested some not really sensible stuff, like using the broadcast address for source MAC address in the Ethernet frame, sending up totally messed up headers, which was also working fine. As long as you keep the frame check sequence or the CRC correct, everything is working as expected. And it boils down to just adding 150 meters, so equally to 150 meters of delay on a single mode fiber. So next time that a colleague asked for a direct connection, we just hooked them up to the Tofino switch, and we didn't get any complaints about the virtual cable that we actually put in there. So concluding this, did we actually achieve in building this layer one switch? Probably not really, because it's still not 100% transparent, because it's regenerating the packet or the physical signal. However, it's quite compelling from a price perspective compared to the other solutions. And obviously, there are a lot of stuff that we could later on add, like traffic amplification, port mirroring, or even if we are up to develop our own data pill encapsulation, but we just don't have a reason yet for doing this. So if you have some thoughts about some use case for this, we are very happy to talk about this. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Sebastian. Thank you for this talk. We don't have time for a Q&A, but there will be breakout rooms for the lightning talks later on. or otherwise just contact Sebastian if you need more information about this. Thank you.
Thanks.